I'm Sarah West, and I invite you to join me for this edition of Art Walks, featuring American realist Stephen Tette. On a late September day, a gentleman paid my gallery a visit. Upon introduction, he stated, "I'm a realist, and you, Sarah, are a realist too." I knew instantly that I had encountered one of the sacred brotherhood, of which a century ago the great artist Robert Henri spoke of. Through art, mysterious bonds of understanding and of knowledge are established among men. They are the bonds of a great brotherhood. Those who are of the brotherhood know each other, and time and space cannot separate them.
My background in the arts actually starts even before I can remember. I get stories from family members, my older brother and my father. I would go to my older brother and I would ask him to draw me things, draw me this superhero or draw me that. And he said I would do that for a little while. And he noticed that I stopped coming to him asking him to do these things. He eventually came looking for me. And he found me, and he found me with a stack of his drawings and another stack of drawings that I had made. So I was actually taking his work and copying his work, right? So at a young age, even before I can remember, art has been a part of who I am. I was one of those who was very passionate about art in school. Part of whatever I was doing would involve a drawing, or involve me doodling all over my paper. And my teachers were very encouraging. They never discouraged me from making art. They, in fact, some looked forward to what I was doing. And it encouraged me to become the artist that I am today.
You've had a very profound life. All of that is kind of spilled into your art, and you have found ways to integrate that into works, ongoing works. Could you elaborate on that?
My background is, it's a rough background. I come from a place where everything was not, art was not encouraged. I come from a rough neighborhood. Mm-hmm. At 16 years old, I lost my best friend. You know, he was shot and killed, right? Which changed my life. Mm-hmm. I was sent to live with my grandmother in a completely different city. At 17 years old, I made a life-changing decision. I joined the military. I dropped out of high school, and I put on boots, and I was serving Uncle Sam. And next thing you know, I was a teenager living in Europe, serving my country. I never stopped making art, even as a soldier. Uh-huh. It was always in a part of who I am and what I do. So as a young man, I went to war. Went to the first Gulf War, which grows you up, mm-hmm. right? I had a little rank under my belt. So instead of me being worried about myself, I had soldiers that I had to take care of, mm-hmm. which kind of helped me. It taught me how to be responsible. It's taught me how to think of things other than myself. From the Gulf War, I ended up in Somalia. That was my very next test, right, where I went through this guerrilla type of warfare. All the time, I'm being educated on life, right? We live in America, mm-hmm. and America is full of freedoms, full of opportunity, right? And I'm in a place where people really don't know where their next meal is coming from. And often in Somalia, they didn't get that next meal. So I grew, right? And I learned, I had an opportunity to learn what it was to be a man. As a combat veteran, my first service in combat was in Desert Shield, Desert Storm. a lot of people may have watched it on TV, but the reality is, unless you were in the Middle East, in the desert, there's a lot of horror that you just won't or don't understand. This is, to me, the closest I can think of a living hell. We were young men stationed in the desert, and one of the duties of the young men stationed in the desert is to burn human waste. And this practice is an old practice that goes back to the Vietnam days, where instead of burying human waste, they would burn it. And a lot of the commanders were these Vietnam guys who remembered this old practice. So they brought it to the desert. So what they would do is they would take these young men and they would require them to wear all of their chemical gear, which is like wearing a winter coat and winter pants in 115, 120 degree weather. The only thing that was not required was the mask. However, this detail, doing this duty, the only thing you would want to wear is that mask. It's 120 degrees. You're wearing a winter coat, winter pants, boots, and a mask, and you're burning other people's feces, human waste. While you're burning the human waste, Saddam Hussein ordered his soldiers to burn the oil fields of the Kuwaitis. So we, as soldiers, were stationed underneath all of these oil well fires. And oil would actually rain from the sky. So you would wake up and your tent would be soaked in oil. Or you would go to the chow hall to eat and your food would taste of oil. This painting happens to represent one of my good friends, Mike Riley, who years later develops cancer. And one of the working titles for this painting is this what gave Mike Riley cancer? It took years for me to allow myself to paint this type of painting. However, it becomes one of the strongest messages I've ever been able to deliver. There's actually clay on the surface of this painting. So we use natural materials. So it's not just an oil painting. It has three-dimensional qualities about it. And it talks about man at his worst, burning feces, and man at his most ignorant, most malevolent, burning the oil so that your enemy can't have it. So I spent 20 years in the military. So I became good at my job. I was good at what I did. But my passion was always art. So once I got out of the military, I went back to school. Didn't go straight into art. I went into biology, believe it or not. I was a biology education major. My mother said to me, okay, you've done 20 years of something that you were good at, but you weren't passionate about it. How about following your passions, following your gifts? And I said, okay. So I took an art class at Columbia State University. My very first art class, the professors came to me and they said, well, we know you're a biology major, but you're not meant for biology, right? You're meant to create art. And it felt great being accepted from these other artists, right? I was just a soldier, and yeah. I never knew anything other than wearing the boots. And it gave me an opportunity to meet some of the world's greatest painters, right? Yeah. Living right here in Columbus.
Right.
And now my works are in places I couldn't have imagined when I was that young boy on the floor drawing and painting.
Through your work, you have recorded the events of war, and you have also documented many very personal matters in your own life. But it serves as a form of documentation that many people, I believe, will relate to.
As artists, we are documenters of society.
Yes.
societies are not known for their war, right?
Right.
Ancient societies are known for their art.
That's right.
Right? And that's what we are. Art for me is a therapy. Coming out of the military, you suffer these traumas. You suffer these things that you have, you struggle to deal with, right?
Yeah.
Seeing things that the normal citizen doesn't see, right? Mm-hmm. And part of working through that is working through art. Picking these things out of my mind and trying to understand on canvas what I experienced in real life. And early in my art career, I rarely touched those subjects, right? Mm-hmm. I wanted my art to be happy. Mm-hmm. I wanted my art to bring the viewer joy,
right?
But the more I became comfortable with who I was as an artist, the more I was willing to tap in.
Those points of vulnerability.
Right, those sensitive areas.
Yeah.
That we carry,
yeah.
Right? And the more I did that, the more my work became a little bit more complete, in depth.
The explorer and writer, Young Everett Roos, once said, why try to conceal one's true longings and hopes in, and I paraphrase, in order to, why conceal them when by speaking of them, we might find someone with whom it resonates? And so, you know, I find that very true even in art. Some topics are difficult to paint and work through. We do touch on points of fragility as well as points of strength, but I think in that we find ourselves, but we also find our common place with our fellow man. I think that art has a way of doing that, and you certainly have conveyed that with your work. I think it touches many people.
Thank you.
To learn more about the events and artists featured on Art Walks, visit the Sarah West Gallery of Fine Art, East Alabama's destination for cultural arts enrichment events, continued fine art education, classes, and programs for all ages. Visit the Sarah West Gallery of Fine Art at thesarahwestgalleryoffineart.com. Like and follow us on social media. Stephen, you've chosen to share a vast majority of pieces with us today. I realize that this is just kind of scratching the surface on your massive body of work, but today we have three specific pieces here. Would you please share more insight into their significance?
The piece behind you started off as a self-portrait. The theory behind this piece is I wanted to create the most socially acceptable me that I could. I knew that I wanted to change the gender. Eventually, I was going to paint a large girl, right? I knew I was going to change the age and the gender. But then I started thinking about me as a social being. This piece sent me straight to my daughter, Michelle. She became who I felt I would be if I was socially mobile. Technically, it's oil on canvas. It's it's painted on a large scale. If she was a whole body, she would be 24 feet tall, but she's just a 4 foot head with shoulders. Because she's so large, the average viewer would find her intimidating when they came up to her. I stole from Da Vinci, Leonardo, and I gave her a little bitty Mona Lisa smile, right? Mm-hmm. So that smile makes her welcoming. But if I was to paint her and her gaze was at the viewer, that would be very intimidating,
right?
Having this large young lady looking at you. And I changed her gaze. I put her gaze off to the side. So her smile invites you in. Her gaze, since it's not on you, it doesn't intimidate you. It doesn't hold you back. I really wanted her to be approachable. One of the inspirations for this painting was actually high-definition television. I wanted a painting that would hold together if you were 6 inches from it or you were 60 feet from it. And one of my favorite details is a line, she has a single hair that starts at the top of her head and it goes down and it wraps around her nose, yes. Right? And unless you're 6 inches from it, you will miss it. She is me at my most acceptable. And the title of this painting is called The Duke's Mixture. This is a painting that really had legs, right? It started small, and then, of course, it grew to this large size. And when I mean it had legs, is it ended up in the governor's office in Georgia. Governor Nathan Deal and his staff, they loved this work, and they loved it so much. It was originally supposed to be there for 6 months, and I got a letter from the governor asking if he could have it for another year and a half, so 2 years in the Capitol. The theme behind this painting is it's a painting of balance, right? It's a balance of opposites, yin and yang, good and bad, light and dark. These are my parents. My father, he is wearing these cool colors, right? They're geometrically shaped. They're obviously store-bought, but they're cold.
Right.
My mother, she's wearing this warm, organic colors. Her shirt is actually painted to look like it's quilted, right? It could be a quilt. So this is handmade, right? She is organic. He's adorned with jewelry and glasses and, you know. She wears none of that. She's simple. This is a landscape. This is an outdoor image. But the only time you see vegetation is in the reflection of the glass. Architecture makes up this landscape, which is kind of counterintuitive to what we think of when we think of landscapes. As an artist, you take your time and you're trying to add these deep meanings to a painting. But then you're adding these little secrets that need to be found. They have this joy that they express, which comes across as, okay, this is the meaning of this painting. It's about joy. But then you find the little man in the window, right? And he has this somber look, right? Their joy is closed eye. They have this closed eye joy, but he has this open-eyed, somber look. And he's looking at you saying, hey, I see you. His youth balances out their age, right? There's so many things that balance each other. My father is uncovered, right? He is outside of the household. My mother is actually covered by the household, right? My father, he carries keys, right? He may leave at any time. My mother, she carries in her hand an elephant, right? She's the matriarch, she's stable. The kid is actually me. And I'm on my mother's side. The head that you see on the end, right, it's simply there to stop the eye from leaving. One of my good friends and mentors, Bo Bartlett, is a painter, is a local painter that most people know. The window is an homage to Bo Bartlett's work, but he painted a series of paintings where he talks about the windows being the eyes of the soul. The marks that are left from the rain could be the tears of what this window has seen. When I'm told that this reminds someone of something that they knew in the past, lends itself to the title, right?
Right.
Strangely familiar, right? Mm-hmm. It's something that is strange and familiar at the same time, right? It's a balance.
You are a proud parent of a number of children that attend Smith Station, and you also are a proud alumni of CSU. I'd certainly like to elaborate more on the pieces that feature your children, some of your recent works.
Yes, the painting behind you is a painting of Smith Station's Spirit Band. My daughter is the central figure, and she's the muse of this Smith Station band. This painting is actually the toughest and hardest painting that I ever had to execute. First of all, the number of figures is, it's a large number of figures. The receding background is actually elevating as it's receding. There's lighting treatments that are have to be treated differently from foreground to background. I love the piece because the piece talks about who we are here in Smith Station, right? The high school football team, the high school band, Smith Station in general, right? It's so different from where I originated from, where I'm coming from. But it gives me such a calm, home feeling. It makes me feel like I belong here. We originally got here in 2004. And since 2004, this has been home, and this has been welcoming. This has become a part of who we are. My daughter, who is here, is she's at Yale University now. But before she was at Yale University, she was the valedictorian of Smith Station High School. I love the piece. The piece, I can hear the music even while I'm looking at the piece, right? I can hear Smith Station Band like I was there. And even the heads of the main figures in the front remind me of musical notes. You know, I'm not a musician, but just the position of their heads reminds me of musical notes on the staff. So Smith Station has been the place where most of my most important works have been created. Smith Station is the place where my career as an artist, you know, blossomed, became more than just something that I was really good at. It became a life. So Smith Station, for me, will always be home and always be the beginning of the major career of my life, not just a place where my kids go to school, a place where my kids remember as their home. This is my home and becomes a bigger part of who I am.
There seems to be a central unity in the whole piece. You talked about the complexities derived from the subject matter. Although it is a very unified subject matter, you're dealing with the forced perspectives as well as the various plays of light. But still, the central focus and the unity within life in general and your life's work here seems to also be reflected in this particular work.
Balance in art is often what I seek. Balance within myself is often what I seek. We live in a world that is so full of chaos,
yes.
So full of troubles. When I work, part of my process is putting on my music and I become one with the canvas. And often I have to remove myself from it because it becomes this place of peace, becomes this place of, it becomes home, right? Just like where I live right now, you know, this small rural area in East Alabama becomes home. And I can lose myself, I can remove myself away from a lot of unpleasant things that, you know, that the world has to offer. And I hope that reflects in my work, because if it does, then the viewer can often come and view my work. And they can, for a brief moment, remove themselves from, you know, the everyday.
In your work, even in viewing some of the topics that air on a very complex note, I think you still feel the honesty and humanity in those pictures. And they must have been very difficult topics to paint. But at the same time, I'm very thankful that they do exist. And I'm thankful that you worked through those pieces so that they can exist, because I do think that the greater majority will see that, will find those hopeful notes in all of those pictures.
This happens to be Opelika High School. And I was there as a parent with my daughter, who was trying out for a state band competition. And while I was there and I was watching my daughter, I noticed the most wonderful play of light that was coming through the window. And it reminded me that I was in Alabama, right? This Southern Cross that was created by the light in this gym became something that I just had to capture on canvas, right? The light comes in from the right side and it just crosses through the gym and it's reflected off of this highly reflective floor. And then it's shot back up through the other wall. And it becomes this phenomenon that I believe that a lot of people may miss, but as an artist, we have we see a little bit more than probably your average viewer. We see these things and then we are moved by them. So this painting is called the Southern Cross. It's still incomplete, but it still has roots that take place right here in East Alabama. And even though it's Opelika High School and they are the enemy, they still have a wonderful environment, which as an artist I can take and reflect on. The title of this painting is Blinded by the Light. The painting was inspired, of course, by church and religion and my relationship to church. I was in church and I listened to a preacher speaking on the Bible. However, the words that were coming out of his mouth were only opinion, and they were actually vulgar opinions of things, and his Bible was closed the whole time he was speaking. And the crowd that listened to this sermon, they were taking everything in as if it was coming from the Word of God. And I was disillusioned by what was being said. So I imagine myself, or I imagine a small child, listening to a man preach on his opinions and his words and being told that this is the Word of God. And I started to have an uneasy feeling. So when I started painting this image, I wanted to use contrasting colors. I used a lot of red and a lot of green. And red and green on a canvas are actually fighting each other, right? They're creating this uncomfortable feeling. The model for this painting is my son, and I used him. I took images of my son, and I had him cover his eyes, and then I covered his ears. And one of the titles of this painting, when it was early in the works, was See No Evil, Hear No Evil, Speak No Evil. However, Blinded by the Light became the ultimate title for this painting. In this painting, there's elements that happen. I removed the identity of anyone besides the child who was there. So there's a lot of artistic interpretation that takes place. There's a reason you can't see anyone's face. All the Bibles have this strong red appearance to them. In my opinion, God is found within us, right? We interpret for ourselves from the Word of God what we are here for. I'm one of the lucky ones. I know that I was created for the purpose of making art, to be a creator of things, right? And when I'm doing that, there's a part of me that says, this makes God happy, right? There's oftentimes when I'm working on a piece that I'm surprised at the turnout. I'm surprised at what happens at the end. And I feel that it comes from a place even beyond myself, right? It's important to know God, but I think it's important to know what God wants from you. So this piece may be religious, but it's also a piece saying you need to know yourself, know where you find yourself with whatever higher spirit you believe in. The title of this painting is Terrain. This painting was painted when I was a student. I was given an assignment to paint a landscape. And I am a different type of thinker. I thought, hey, one morning I woke up and I looked at my bed and I noticed that it appeared to have this landscape. So I took a couple of snaps of it and I suggested it to my professor, who quickly dismissed it as folly, you know, that you could never pull that off. And I love a challenge, so I chose to do it anyway, under threat of bad grade. I started working the painting, and as I started working the painting, my professor quickly came around to my side and believed that I could create something special. The sheets are often compared to water, or they're often compared to rolling hills that are coming up on the blanket, which is symbolizes the shore or a mountain range. The open window to the left clearly is representing the sun coming over a hill. It's a great play on light in this painting. And for me, this was my first fully realized oil painting. It's one of that I'm most proud of. When it was complete, Columbus was hit with a tornado. And the tornado came through the downtown area and ripped off part of the roof on the Corn Center, which is downtown Columbus. And this painting happened to be in the Corn Center. After the tornado, this painting was found floating in about a foot of water. So there's still water damage there, where, you know, paint was chipped off. I considered touching it up, but it's something about the survival or the strength of this painting, and something about, you know, the scars that are left when we go through something traumatic, which makes this painting almost like me. I'm proud of the scars that I have.
Thank you for joining us for this edition of Art Walks. I'm Sarah West, and I hope you'll join us next time.